Would you remain standing as we honor the reading of God's holy word? Our scripture this morning comes from Romans chapter 14, verses 1 through 13. Listen to the word of the Lord. Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain. And those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat, for God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall, and they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe the day, observe it in honor of the Lord. Also those who eat, eat in honor of the Lord, since they give thanks to God, while those who abstain, abstain in honor of the Lord, and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord, so that whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brothers or sisters? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God, for it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God, so that each of us will be accountable to God. Let us, therefore, no longer pass judgment on one another, but resolve instead never to put a stumbling block or a hindrance in the way of another. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Let's pray. Lord God, we pray that my words would be your words, and that the meditations of all of our hearts would be acceptable in your sight, our God, and our Redeemer. Amen. Well, today we are continuing our series looking at the book of Romans, Paul's letter to the church at Rome. In chapter 14, we can assume that Paul has been informed of a quarrel that is going on. Whatever else Jesus may have envisioned for his church, the one thing Jesus was clear about was that we'd probably never be finished forgiving one another, at least from time to time, at least while we're still here on earth. To become a part of the body is to be as Jesus prayed for. He really wanted his community, his believers, to be one. In mind, spirit, he wanted us to be that part. And so, being that oneness is important because this is showing the world the love that God has for us in Jesus Christ. And oneness and unity are all about love. Last week, we were reminded about the royal law, right? That we are to love our neighbor as yourself. And so Romans 14 stands as a witness to the fact that from the very earliest days of the church, there were conflicts, there were issues. And fellow believers of that time had to work them out, and hopefully with grace. But the question is for us here today, is how should believers who strongly disagree on non-essential matters relate to one another? The answer, I think, is found in our scripture this morning. I have organized my sermon like a good Presbyterian in 3 points. Point one is to embrace acceptance and non-judgment. Point two, pursue peace and edification. And point three, avoid being a stumbling block to fellow believers. Now, this quarrel that has been brewing is about food. I heard some of you tell us when you hurt. It does seem silly to us that a conflict like this that Paul has to address in his book or his letter to the Romans has to do with food. I mean, what is this all about? Is Paul saying that if for health reasons that you have chosen to be a vegetarian, you're an heretic? Is he saying that? I don't think so. We know that the first reading of the Old Testament, we know that God had established rules and regulations for the Israelites, really to form community, to build an identity. But it also showed that God was showing that he wanted his people to come before him and be clean. So it's two things. Most of these regulations were about meat. There were things that he could touch, or they would become ceremonially unclean, which means they couldn't go and worship at the temple or worship in their synagogues. And really, you could hang out with others who were clean. And here, as we can tell, there are some part of this Roman congregation is some Jewish Christians who have been converted to Christianity, and they believe that the kosher laws still apply, as well as the observance of Jewish high holy days. However, there were also believers in Rome that thought that such rituals and food laws and practices had nothing to do with being a Christian. Now, my wife Shelley and I have had the great fortune of being godparents to Jack and Mary Atkins. They're now grown adults. But Jack, when he was younger, was struggling with giving up the bacon. You know, the pacifier. All kids go through this. I have a grandchild. Her name's Ivy Sue. And I'm so excited these days now where, trying to get out of the bakery, still kind of like going to the bakery, But Jack was really struggling because this baby had been with him his whole life, right? I mean, it was his friend. It was a comforter. It gave him great comfort. And so he was kind of struggling with this. And, finally decided, okay, we're done with the cookies. Jack agreed, But one day he was walking through the house and he had a little bulge in his pocket. And his grandfather asked him, "Hey, Jack, what's in your pocket?" And he pulled it out and he said, "Just a case." And I think this is kind of the attitude of the Jewish Christians and their attitude about these observing these ceremonial laws. They were comforting to them. They've been doing these things for their whole lives. And so, just in case, they might have said something like, "Oh, I believe in Jesus. But just to be safe, I'm going to follow these rules and regulations just to make sure I'm acceptable and complete," right? I mean, you can understand that. It didn't take too long before these two groups, Paul calls the weak and the strong, started to regard the other with suspicion. Those who refused to keep kosher snickered at the immaturity of the weaker group. Those upset people, those who were so antiquated, they probably said stuff like, "Oh, look at those weak Christians. How quaint, how ancient, that they still do these things, right?" On the other hand, the Jewish Christians found plenty of cause to look down on others too. So they must think stuff like, "Well, how dare they live so casually? Haven't they read Holy Scriptures that were handed down to us from Moses and from the prophets? say Hail Mary, she brings her casserole, right? She's got her casserole over. I know some of you ladies have these casserole boards. Some of you guys, I'm fond of casseroles from Minnesota. And she brings it, she's probably going to want to serve it to her guests. She takes the foil off, and what do you see? Scalloped potatoes with ham and bacon? I mean, really, this was going to cause a lot of trouble. I mean, nobody's going to hear that thing. And then the others are going to be offended. Mary and her crew are going to say, well, why are they so people so sensitive? It's just a little bacon. Well, it's not difficult to see that a little heated pressure must have arisen between these opposing groups. And this is what Paul has to deal with, these kind of tangle of issues. And he needed to do it for the sense of the whole church, shall we? And it was probably, I think it's a really good thing that we noticed something very critical in this. Before we look at what Paul says, I think we should look at something like, we should fully understand. And we think that this is silly, right? This is over food. You're sweating because of food. We wouldn't do that. But both sides of this dispute were really genuine. They were very concerned. And they have spiritual and theological and biblical components to their arguments. Jewish Christians saw it as a matter of fidelity to Scripture. And Christians, the other Christians, the Gentile Christians, said that, you know, it ignores the wonderful truth of our salvation. That we are free of all that. There's freedom in Christ Jesus, right? So, in other words, in the minds of the people, these people that were involved, this wasn't a matter of personal trait, of personal peace. This wasn't just whether, you know, you like Beethoven or Mozart. These things were really important to them. And these could be argued in biblical and theological terms. Now, Paul kind of takes his hand, doesn't he? Because he calls the one group weak and the other strong. Clearly, Paul has his opinion on the matter. What he's still calling those that are keeping the kosher laws, the weaker party. And those that are worried, were not worried about these kosher laws, really, in Paul's mind, I think, saw them as maybe more mature, stronger, maybe had a stronger grasp of what the Christian life was all about. But who is weak among us? Who is strong? We all are sometimes weak and sometimes strong. In some areas, we're strong. In some areas, we're weak. And that's the beauty of being in community and being together with other Christians. I mean, who among us can fully understand the fullness of the gospel message? And who among us has this Christian life all figured out? What gets in the way of community is our expectation of it. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, in his book, Life Together, says this: he who loves his or her dream of community more than the Christian community itself becomes a destroyer of the latter, even though his personal intentions may be ever so honest and earnest and sacrificial. So Bonhoeffer, in his book Life Together, reminds us that community is not something we create. It's really a gift of God. It's given to us, and we need to receive it on its terms. Strong party was right, but they were doing it wrong. And when Christians get their focus on the center of their faith, that is Jesus Christ, they get into arguing non-essential matters. Well, this unity comes in. So these stronger people, they might have thought that, hey, Paul's on our side. verse, it says, you may be right in theory, but you're wrong in practice when you look down on these other people. The followers of Jesus Christ are called to embrace acceptance and not judgment towards one another. And here's where Paul, I think, is brilliant. Because he doesn't get bound in this debate, he actually calls upon a higher authority. Paul says, do you know why you should accept other people the way they are? Because God has already accepted them the way they are. And that, my friends, should be enough for anybody. Paul goes on further to talk about the one Lord Jesus Christ, whom all Christians serve. See, everything we do, everything we say, everything we need, all of that, it comes under the authority of Jesus, our Lord and Master. So, we're all under this gracious tent, right? And we're all individually accountable to God. We're not accountable to each other. We're accountable to God. And so, we must remember that it's important for us to understand, because that creates the unity in the body. I know this might sound kind of paradoxical, but when we submit to the Lordship of Jesus Christ and live out this ethic of love where we place others before us, before ourselves, that is the way to really, truly experience the kind of life that we were created for. And that brings us to our next point. What should we do within the church community? How should believers relate to one another? And Paul says our focus should be on pursuing peace and edification in the church community. And so Paul is responding to both the weak and the strong, and he responds to them in love. Both are acting on their own consciousness, but their honest scruples don't need to be rules for the whole church. I mean, there are things in our church that are essential and are essential to the faith, and they are worth fighting for. I love that our denomination has put those essential talents out. We don't need to argue about non-essentials that create disharmony in the body of Christ. So, if you and I, we encounter a believer who bows his knee to Jesus Christ, who can, with his mouth, confess that Jesus is Lord, then that should be enough for us. We don't have to criticize everything about that person or one another in the church. We don't need to argue or debate issues that are not central to our common confession. And that is true even when things might be considered spiritual or biblical, as they were in the case of the world. Individuals may have different practices and observances, and we should make it a priority that we work towards unity of the body over our personal preferences. In the end, Paul tells us, the weak and the strong, to lead one another in peace. Both are guilty of judging one another, of measuring each other in their faith. And so, we can't be about grading one another that way. In life and death, we belong to Jesus alone. He is the one that is taking charge of us. Furthermore, it is His grace that covers us when we do make mistakes. Maybe we do get a little uptight on occasion about our shaping of our religious life. Maybe some of us are a little loose with our shaping of our religious life. If Jesus can forgive us and bear with us, then we should be able to do the same with our brothers and sisters in the faith. And so Paul calls for a mutual love, even through disagreement. says he was raised from the dead, but only in Romans 14 it says Christ died and lived again. Christ died and lived again. He is the living Lord. It's a subtle reminder to us that the presence of the living Lord is here with us in our community. He's here now. He wasn't just whisked out of sight after his resurrection. He returned because of life. My life, your life, our lives that are shared together, our mutual life together as a community of faith. That is what Jesus is interested in right now. And he is always interested in that. And Paul would say that this living Lord is in close proximity. His presence is among his people in the church. Richard Mauve once noted that while growing up, most of us were taught by our parents that there are certain things one simply does not say in polite company. Did you hear that before? But Richard Mauve says this. He said, Christians of all people should recognize that we are always in polite company. The living Lord is here, right? So when we are in meetings, or we are in choir, or we're out on the patio, Jesus is with us. He's there. He knows us that way. And that brings us to our third and final point, and that is to avoid being a stumbling block. We have a responsibility to our brothers and sisters in the faith. We should not do anything that causes someone to stumble in their faith. Our zeal for being right should never lead others astray. Now, I know that living in community with fellow believers is not always easy. It's probably the most challenging thing we do as people who are disciples living out our faith. Right? But we have to do the hard work of building community. And that begins with accepting that we are all under the Lordship of Jesus Christ and that He is in our living community. And so, we then strive to be examples of love, loving others like Jesus loved us, seeking understanding, looking for ways that we can encourage and lift up our brothers and sisters in the faith. Now, from time to time, we will have disagreements. We'll have different points of view. Discussion is good. Conversation is needed. By the way, that's very Presbyterian, right? We need to remember that we do all of this in the presence of the one Lord Jesus Christ. Our living Lord is with us in these discussions, in these conversations, in our meetings. And He is our constant companion right now. He's with us here in worship. So let us remember the importance of embracing acceptance, not judging others, and not pursuing peace, and avoiding actions that might hinder another's spiritual journey. And by living together and embracing this unity and love, we can build a stronger and more vibrant church, and we can show the world this love of Christ that we have experienced, and allow others to draw near to that same love. And may we always May we contribute our love to the unity of the body of Christ, so that those outside